Good morning. Welcome to the Lord's Day. I am your lay leader, Sam Erkonen. Thank you for joining us in worship this morning. Members, guests, and to our friends who are with us worldwide, we extend the invitation. When you're in the Chicago area, we'd love to have you join us in person. We're at the corner of Lockport and Illinois Streets in Plainfield, Illinois. Please take time to complete the communications and prayer request form. It's in the bulletin or may be downloaded from the website. Forms will be collected during service and all prayers will be lifted up today and remembered throughout the week. Join us for refreshments after worship in the East Room. You're welcome to make use of our family worship room located just outside the sanctuary in the West Wing. The service is on the big screen there. Please review the announcements in your bulletin. Does anyone have any other announcements at this time? Yes, Mary.
I just wanted to let everyone know that the tax letters to your contribution letters are ready. So if you'd like to pick them up, that would at least save us some mailing costs. Okay?
Any other announcements? Yes, Daryl.
Joshua's birthday today.
Happy birthday. Any other announcements? Hearing no further announcements, let us continue with our call to worship. Praise be to God who rescues us from the power of darkness, who redeems us and sets us free. Praise be to Jesus Christ, the firstborn of all creation, through whom all things were made in heaven and on earth. Praise be to the Spirit of God, whose presence sustains us and whose breath renews all creation. Behold, I am making all things new. Come, O God, and make your home within us. Pour out your spirit and renew the face of the earth. Please stand and join me in our praise hymn, which is number 635, He Leadeth Me, O Blessed Thought.
Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, through the power of your Holy Spirit, we ask God that you would lead us into the very presence of the throne room of God today. God, that we would enter into your presence. And Father, that now, God, our surrender would be complete and total to you. And Father, as we pray together, we ask, Lord, that your blessing be upon our congregation. And God, that our congregation, be they in this building now or traveling or sick or afflicted or unable to be here or those who are watching, God, that today the presence and power of your Holy Spirit would meet every need. God would reach into every heart. And Lord, that we would surrender ourselves to your perfect and holy will. God, I ask that you seal this service by the power of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, that we would be free to worship you in spirit and in truth today. And God, that today we would know the presence and the power of praise. For God, that is the thing that we're looking to understand more of today. Our praise, the honor that we give to you, that you would bless and anoint us. Father, we pray these things in Christ's name, and everyone said, amen. Please be seated and turn to page 743. Well, prayerfully, you've had a chance to fill out your prayer request. If you haven't, take your time. You have the opportunity to put it into the offering plate as it comes around later. But today, I want to challenge you to give me your deepest, darkest, the thing that you need most of all, prayer requests today. Because I'll tell you, prayer is something that is the lifeblood of the church. Yes, we need people, we need money, we need a building to meet in, we need subscribers, we need offerings, we need all that stuff. But without prayer, all is but lost. So today, I ask you to give me your needs. Not just the things that you want for tomorrow or the next day, but something that's deep inside of you that you really need. Maybe it's a relationship healed. Maybe it's a physical ailment that you have. Maybe it's just the fact that you want to be able to praise God more every day. Whatever your need is, please give that to me. And we'll send it out. Stell and I pray for them. Other people here pray for them. I go over them several times a day sometimes just to lift up your needs. So If Drew would come and get this, we're going to turn to page 622 and sing. Let's pray together. Father, you know the needs that have been listed in this box. You know our heart's desire is to love you more. But God, you know that deep within us are needs that we have that sometimes can't even be spoken by the audible words. And God, I'm so thankful that you've given us your Holy Spirit, your life, your love, your power within us. That God, when we don't even know how to speak, the Spirit makes intercession for us. Lord, when all we know how to do is to groan and just to agonize in prayer, that God, you know the depths of our heart. So, Father, upon these requests, we ask that you would do what any good father would do. Grant the wishes, the prayers, the petitions of their children. Father, your word says that if we, being evil, know how to give good gifts, how much more will you, our Heavenly Father, give to us? To those who ask for the Holy Spirit, breathe upon us today, Father. Breathe upon these needs. Bring healing where the body needs to be healed. Bring healing to relationships. Bring healing to our finances. Bring healing to our homes and our families. Bring healing, Father, to this nation. Father, we've asked for years for you to bless America, and now it's time for America to stand and bless God. Oh, America, bless God. Father, your word says, blessed are the people whose Lord is God. May our nation turn to you. May our lives be examples of your love, and may we today be fitted for your kingdom according to your perfect will. We pray this in Christ's name. And everyone said, amen.
Today's scripture reading is from Psalm 150, verses 1 through 6. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His actions, or His acts of power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise Him with the harp and the lyre. Praise Him with the timbrel and dancing. Praise Him with the strings and pipe. Praise Him with the clash of cymbals. Praise Him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And everybody said, amen. Amen.
All by my lonesome today. So through this morning, we've carrying on in from the adult Sunday school to hear that prayer is very important. And I want to bring a story from the book of Matthew that has to do with Jesus and prayer. And a lot of you may go to, okay, maybe this is the Lord's Prayer, but this is another example that Jesus has about prayer. And this is Matthew 26:36, and it says, then Jesus went to them in a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit here while I go and pray. Then talking with him, Peter and the two sons of Zebedee became sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me. And going a little farther, he fell on his face and prayed and said, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. And he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, so could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. Again, for the second time, he went and prayed, my Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done. And again, he came out and they were sleeping again. He found them sleeping. Their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for a third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, sleep and take your rest later on. See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. And then we know the after part, that Jesus is arrested and then finally taken off to his death. But what can we glean from this section with prayer? That when Jesus was praying, you know, there's things that we want. And he's bringing the Father his concerns, that the Father wants to hear these concerns. And then he prays the best prayer that you could do is, your will be done, God. That God's will is a perfect will. And sometimes, I mean, right after this, God's will, Jesus went to be crucified. And sometimes bad things will happen. But ultimately, what do we see coming out of this horrible, horrible time in history to where the Son of God goes and gets crucified? That by doing that, he accomplishes salvation for people, for his people. And that is a glorious type thing. So as we pray, may we all pray that not your will, not your will, not our will, Lord, but your will be done.
Praise the Lord. Would the ushers come forward, please, and we'll receive our morning offering. We stand. Heavenly Father, we pray that your blessing would be upon these gifts, tithes, and offerings. Father, as we return unto you a portion of the magnitude of things you've given to us, you've given us finances, you've given us abilities, you've given us a home to live in, you've given us family. God, we could go on and name and name and name. But Father, we return this small portion unto you, asking you to make us, the leaders of this church, wise in how we use your gifts. We pray this in Christ's name, and everyone said, Amen. How many of you know that? God is worthy. Thou art worthy. I love the words to that. Thou art worthy, thou art worthy, thou art worthy. We could say it over and over again. Thou art worthy, thou art worthy. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive honor and glory and power. Thou art worthy, O God. Thou art worthy. You're worthy, O God. The past week or so, I've been preaching about praise and worship. Last week, I talked about what worship is the worth-ship of God. It's actually the measuring rod that we lay down to declare where we put God in our priority of things. This week proved to be one of those weeks where I had to put into action what I preached on Sunday. And as I sat in this sanctuary several days this week, I actually got lost in worship. And I got lost in praise. Psalm 100 says, "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord," King James says. So if you have breath, on the count of three, say, "Praise ye the Lord" with me. One, two, three.
Praise ye the Lord.
Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. I thought about that when I was putting this together. Praise is the act of expressing approval or admiration. Worship is reverent honor and homage paid to God. While most Christians think praise and worship are interchangeable, there's a tremendous difference and a tremendous power in praise. If you want to read a good book, go to the library or go to Amazon and see if you can find Power to Praise by a gentleman named Merlin Carruthers. It's a book that was written back in the 60s. I know, I'm showing my age, but realizing that one of the most powerful books that you could read besides the Bible is this little 90-page booklet that says, The Power to Praise. There was an example of a lady in this book. She was in her late 70s, really crippled up with arthritis, and she had very good silverware in her drawer, and she decided to polish it all. So she stood by the drawer and polished every piece and had it all laying out on the counter and was ready to put it back in and knocked every piece on the floor. And she looked at the floor and she looked at her hands and she looked at the drawer and she just wanted to cry. Have you ever felt like that? You just wanted to cry. But instead, she had just read Merlin Carruthers' book, and she began to praise God. And somehow, each piece of silverware was picked up and put into the right slot in the right place in the drawer. And when it was over with, and she had done it all with the presence and the power of God and the power of praise, she could have done what most of us would do, and that's complain, because she had to wash the silverware all over again and polish it again. But she didn't. She praised God for the fact that she was able to do it. Praise is the means and response to the infilling of the Holy Spirit of God. If you have the life of God living in you, the praise that comes out of you is supernatural. Ephesians 5, 18 through 19 says, And do not be drunk with wine. And do not be drunk with wine. And do not be drunk with wine or slushies or anything else that you can make, which is an excess. You see the three who looked at each other down here, didn't you? Which in his excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart. To the Lord. Singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Praise and worship triggers the overflow of God's Spirit in our hearts. We only enter God's presence through praise. Psalm 100, verse 4. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Not only enter into God's presence through praise, but also filled with His presence through worship. You show me a worshiping group of people, I'll show you the presence of God just flowing like rivers of unending water. As worship rises, the Spirit of God overflows. James 4:8, draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. John 7:37 through 39, If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, you remember what that word means, trust. He who believes in me, as the scripture says, from his innermost beings will flow rivers of living water. This he spoke of the Spirit. This he spoke of the Spirit. Whom those who believe in him were to receive. Praise is also the response of being filled with God's Spirit, which cries out within us prayer and praise. The infilling cries out with prayer and praise. Romans 8:15. You have received a spirit of adoption whereby we cry. No, we cry, Abba, Father. Remember I told you a couple of weeks ago about the revelation that I had about when Jesus taught the Lord's Prayer and how He said, Our Father? wasn't necessarily the title, but it was bringing God to a level of Father. Bringing God from this ethereal person sitting on his great throne ready to smash you if you made a mistake to our Heavenly Father. He puts his arms around us and loves us when we stumble and fall. One day, one of our friends came to our house when we were living in Cheshire, Ohio, and Kelly was a wee little girl. And Janet walked in the front door, and our steps went two steps, a landing, and then 12 steps up to a landing, and then two more steps. Well, Kelly was standing in the landing and saw Janet and jumped. Boom, boom, ba boom, ba boom, 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 boom. Well, I could have been a typical father and said, "You stupid kid, what's the matter with you?" But I didn't. I ran over and I grabbed her. I picked her up and I loved her and I hugged her. And it was so comforting to her that, to me, that she wasn't hurt, number one. And two, that the more I hugged her, the more I talked to her, the more I told her how much I loved her and she was going to be all right, she hugged me that much tighter each time I said something. It's one of the reasons I love picking up Paisley, because she's just a bundle of love. When our grandkids were little, you'd pick them up and they'd hug your neck and they'd pop your neck, almost pop your head off your shoulders. They'd squeeze so hard, no matter what they went through. Father, Abba, Dad. Throughout the scripture, people are worshiping. Worshiping and magnifying God when filled with the Holy Spirit. Worship is one of the evidences of being filled with the Holy Spirit. Did you know that? So many people say, and believe me, I've been in Pentecostal circles, I've been in charismatic circles, and you know, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? Yes. Have you spoken tongues? It doesn't matter whether I spoke in tongues. What matters is that I have the spirit of worship. And worship flows from the body that's filled with the Spirit of God. Now, my Pentecostal brethren and my charismatic brethren are going to start throwing rocks at me at this point, but I really could care less, because the Scripture says, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. It doesn't say out of your belly will flow different languages or anything else. What flows is worship. And praise. Acts chapter 10, verses 45 through 46. And on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost, for they heard them speak with tongues and magnified God. Praise creates an atmosphere of hearing from God. I have people ask me all the time, how do you hear from God? You know what the simplest answer in the world is? Praise God. Just praise Him. Just praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the evening, praise Him at supper time. Oh, that'd make a good song, wouldn't it? Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the evening, praise Him, praise Him, praise Him till the sun goes down. Boom, boom, boom. You ever heard that song? No? Some of you have. Whoever went to vacation Bible school or went to camp, heard that song or sang it or whatever. But you see, that's how we hear from God. We praise Him in all of our circumstances. Paul wrote to us in Thessalonians and Philippians, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus. In everything. You say it's hard to give thanks when my bank account's empty. It's hard to give thanks when my toe hurts. It's hard to give thanks when there's no food in my refrigerator. It's hard to give thanks. But let me tell you, it's harder not to give thanks when you know what God has done for you. If you want to hear from God, you worship Him and praise Him. It says in Acts chapter 13, verse 2, while they were ministering to the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said. I love it in when Peter was preaching there just after the day of Pentecost. Peter was preaching this himself silly. Peter loved to preach. I don't know anybody like that. I mean, Peter just loved to preach, and he was preaching. And while he was saying, the Holy Spirit spoke. If you go back and read Peter's message, it was a message of praise, declaring what God, through Jesus, had done for him. Can you imagine? Stephen. You know who Stephen is or was? The very first martyr in the New Testament church. And you know what Stephen's words were? Father, lay not this sin to their charge. Don't hold it against them. Why? Because I love you, Lord. That'd make a good song too, wouldn't it? I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. You'd think, I think I know how to sing. When I'm in service where praise and worship begins to flow, the anointing doubles, quadruples, exponentially grows. You see, the real key to hearing from God is praise. Even in the midst of spiritual battle, praise is important. Did you know that? It's when we're going through a time of difficulty and spiritual conflict that we desperately need to hear from God. In 2 Kings chapter 3, verses 15 through 16, Ahab and Jehoshaphat ran out of water while going into battle of Moab. Jehoshaphat said, is there not a prophet of the Lord here that may be inspired by him? One of the king's servants says, Elisha, the son of Shaphat, is here. Jehoshaphat said, the word of the Lord is with him. The word of the Lord is with him. What brings the anointing? Praise and the word of the Lord. They went to Elisha and told him, bring me a minstrel. He said, bring me a minstrel. I'd run in and get my guitar. But they played a song. And after they played the song, I want you to hear what happened. After they played the song, thus says the Lord. If you followed me down the road and there was nobody in the truck but me, and you could get alongside of me and watch me drive down the road, you'd think I was crazy. Well, the way you can tell is this. I'm usually driving down the road with my knee on the wheel, both hands up in the air, and I'm singing to the top of my lungs, and people are going, but you know what? The Spirit of the Holy God is setting me free. You see, Jehoshaphat wanted to be set free. He needed water. They were going to lose the battle. And Elisha said, go get me some kind of musician. Oh, there's no precedent for that. David played and soothed Saul's heart. All through the Psalms, if you read them, it's nothing more than a musical treatise on how to enter into God's presence. Thus says the Lord. It was when the musician began to play that the Lord spoke to Elijah, giving him the needed word to lead into victory. We wonder why we never experience victory. It's not because you're not a good guitar player. It's not because you can't play the trumpet or you can't play the piano or you can't play the harmonica or the jew's harp or you can't play a comb with some tissue paper wrapped around it. Or you probably think that you can't even play the radio if you don't get it on the right channel. But let me tell you something. It doesn't matter how good you do it. It matters that you do it. It's only after the musician began to play that the Lord spoke to Elisha and gave him the word of the Lord. That's why a worship leader's position in a church is so important. That's why there are times when I just throw the book down and say, okay, here, let's sing this song. We'll sing a song, and I want to get us involved in it. We did this at Cedar Lake and Autumn Leaves the other day. We did Blessed Assurance, and you know how I love to do Blessed Assurance. I have people that can't remember where they were yesterday. They were singing to the top of their lungs and holding Blessed Assurance out like it was a choir. And when we walked out of there, I said to Stella, isn't it odd how the Spirit of God just flows in a place like this? When here we are in a beautiful building with many of you with good minds. I said many, I didn't say all. Many of you with good minds. And all we can think about is the smell of pancakes and sausage. All we can think about is what time it is. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. I want you to know, folks, you guys have something no one else in the world has. You have the ability to praise God in the midst of the sanctuary, not just the building, but the presence of God. People who minister in worship should never underestimate their position. They're the ones who set the atmosphere for the church hearing God to speak. That's why sometimes I have a great song picked out at the end and I change it. That's why sometimes the song that we do just before the sermon, past month, I've been using different songs. Is singing the only way to worship? No. Is singing the only way to praise? No. But it's a good way. It's a way that we all can do it. You say, yeah, but I don't do it well. And you've heard me sing? Thank you very much. Praise releases stress and anxiety. I'm going to say that again. Praise releases stress and anxiety. I'm going to say it one more time. Prayer releases stress and anxiety. Philippians 4, 6 through 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The prescription for stress and anxiety is in Philippians 4, 6 through 8. And this prayer and praise and positive mindset, we need to cast all of our care on Him. Not just the itty-bitty part, all of it. How are you going to pay your taxes this year? I don't know. But if you give that to God, if you cast all that on God, He'll find a way. How are you going to make it to the end of the month? I don't know. But I do know if you cast all your care on Him, He careth for you. And it says very plainly that He will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. We need to be casting it all on Him. 1 Peter 5:7. That said, prayer alone is not enough. Prayer focuses on the problem, where praise focuses on the situation. Prayer focuses on the problem. We had prayer requests today in prayer meeting just before we came in here for a little girl named Maya. She's had cancer for 6 years. She's 10 years old. According to some of you, that's not fair. In the grand scheme of things, I agree, it's not fair. Any of you over 20 years old in this room know that life is not always fair. Nor are our parents, nor are our siblings, nor are our uncles or our aunts or our relatives, nor the church, nor the government, nor the community. Casting all your care on Him, for He careth for you. It's important to pray, but don't stop there. We must always move from prayer to praise, so we don't dwell on the problem, but on the solution. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 through 29, Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest because you have enough money, because you have enough people, because you have enough whatever." No, rest for your soul. In this life, we will have tribulation. Jesus promised you that. But He said, with the tribulation, I give you the plan to beat the stress and the anxiety. Prayer releases the generosity of God. Think about how you feel every time your kid comes up and says, Mom, can I have that? Dad, will you give me? Huh? And what do we do when those kids start saying, "Man, you're the greatest, Mom. You're the greatest, Dad"? We get our egos inflated a little bit, and we do everything we can to buy them whatever it is they want. And we give it to them, and they look at us like, thanks. You see, that's the picture God wants to change in us. He wants us not to just beg God. He wants us to praise God for who and what He is and who He has been and who He will be. And then He wants to give us things, and then He wants us to be appreciative. He wants us to be thankful. In everything, give thanks. You say, "Yeah, but doesn't that mean all the bad things?" No, that even means the good things, folks. In everything, give thanks. You're looking great. Things are going wonderful for you, but you still have to have knee surgery. Give thanks. We all have problems. Is there anyone here that doesn't have a problem? But we also, every last one of us, has something we can praise God for and about. But many of us are too stubborn to do it, because we want God on our terms. And God said, "My terms, friends." Isaiah chapter 65, verse 24 says, "It will also come to pass that before They call, I will answer. And while they are still speaking, I will hear. How great is that? Praise brings this to fulfillment in our lives. If we will spend more time in praise and worship, we will find a lot less to pray about. If we spend more time praising God and worshiping who He is and giving worth to Him, we'll have to spend less time offering petitions because He's already going to meet them. Prayer causes our enemies to flee. Did you know that? Or praise causes our enemies to flee. Think about this. Your enemies are coming in like a flood. And you're standing here going, hallelujah, bless God, praise you, Jesus, everything is going to be all right. And the enemies come about halfway down the aisle and they say, there's something wrong with this guy. There's definitely something wrong here. He shouldn't be praising. We're coming in to take over and to destroy. And he's standing here with his arms raised up saying, thank you, Jesus, praise the Lord, glory to God. Now, I know y'all think I sound like I come from down south, which I do. But may I tell you something? That praising God in the midst of trouble makes your enemies lose their mind. It's just like smile, and it'll make your enemies wonder what you're up to. In the midst of the worst situation. I only came that close to losing my temper at church people by that much, one time. Just once. This is going out over the World Wide Web. And some of the people that I know that know this story will probably hear it. But that's okay. We were in Dover, Illinois. And the church was really wanting us to leave. So they decided we needed a new septic system in our yard. And we'd had an acre garden planted. And this was in September. Backhoe, end loader, our garden went to the proverbial hot spot in a basket. And the guys who were instrumental in doing it were standing about 10 feet outside our window just laughing themselves silly. And I was okay with it. Didn't bother me until I looked in the window and I saw my wife sitting at that window, crying her heart out because of the work and the multiplication coming back to us in that garden that was destroyed. And I came that close to losing my temper. But instead, I went in and I put my arms around her and we prayed and we began to praise God. And we spent the next 13 years in Beecher, and the next 13 years in Park Forest. And we're going to spend the rest of our ministry in Plainfield, Illinois. Why? Because it says in everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. If you'll praise God in the midst of the worst situation you can think of, I promise you that God will work things out and your mind will be blown by the way He does it. I want you to know something as I close this. When praising God, most people look at you like you have lost your mind. To the Harvard intellect, to the incredibly educated, we are nothing but stupid, blind people who trust a God that they cannot see, who believe in a God that is some kind of a overseer. But I believe in a personal Father who loves me beyond anything anyone can try to say or do to change my mind. Amen is right. Would you pray with me, please? God, you are so good. Father, I love you. And I will love you with my last ounce of breath. And as Job so eloquently put it, though he slay me, yet will I praise him. I praise you, Father. I praise you, Son. And I praise you, Holy Ghost. Our Father, I give you glory. In Jesus' name I pray, and asking this blessing, amen. Let's turn in our hymn books, please, to our closing hymn. It's number 708. For our benediction tonight, today, whatever this is, I'd like you to say something with me. On the count of three, I would like you to declare the benediction of three words. Praise the Lord. One, two, three.
Praise the Lord.
You're dismissed.